Hello again, this is Kurgan here. Now, so far all I've done is BF3 weapon reviews, but with the new download content coming out and a bunch of new things, I figured I might as well do some coverage on the things that I find interesting from this as well. So, let's dive right into that. Recently, there was an interview with Nicholas Figueres from DICE, and he basically explained the setting for Aftermath, and he said that it takes place during the earthquake. If you played the single-player campaign, you'll have seen that earthquake, and it also takes place during the aftershocks that follow it, and those will be affecting gameplay as well. Now, the real question is what will we be seeing from this download content? And the first answer to that is new player character models. Now, if you have paid attention to the recent update to Battlelog, we got some new avatars for everybody's account. And I'm assuming that these are going to be the ones that are going to be added with the download content. Because if you look at them, these people look like they have been in really rough situations. Some of them have blood on them and such. So even if it isn't them, it's going to probably be ones that look a lot like that. Also, we'll be seeing three new vehicles, and no, none of them are tanks. We'll be seeing a new Hummer and a new Vodnik. Now, both of these are equipped with a grenade launcher or a heavy machine gun, and the real interesting one, the third vehicle, is a civilian van with a machine gun that will be controlled by the driver. Now, this will be really interesting to see how they do it, how much armor it's going to have, how much damage the weapon's going to do, and I think it's only going to be able to hold one person, but it's really interesting that the machine gun is going to be able to be controlled by the driver, so it's should be a very fun vehicle to drive around. And as I already mentioned, the aftershocks that we're going to have to play through. Now, when you play on these levels, I don't know if it'll be on a random timer or how exactly it's going to work, but sometimes you're going to get those aftershocks and you're going to have to take cover because, of course, Battlefield Frostbite Engine has destruction and debris falling on you can kill you, so I'm not sure how this will exactly affect aim as well, if it'll be like suppression or what, but it's an interesting game mechanic and it's something that you're really going to have to probably watch out for because you're not going to want to die to that falling debris. And then we got a bunch of new things, like we got one new weapon, a crossbow, which a bunch of people have already been talking about, one new game mode, Scavenger, which I'll be covering here in a little bit, 10 new assignments, and 10 new dog tags. I'm going to throw a link in the description to a compilation image showing all of the assignments and the details of them, so just take a look down in the description and you'll be able to see that. Also, if you're playing on console, there's going to be 5 new achievements or trophies depending on which console you play on. And the other really interesting thing about this download content is Close Quarters brought Gunmaster game mode in. Well, that didn't get transferred over to Armored Kill. It's actually being put on these new maps, so that's really interesting. We'll see how it plays out because these maps are going to be a little bit bigger and hopefully a bit more open than the maps that are in Close Quarters. Now, let's dive into that crossbow that everybody's curious about. There's actually 2 different crossbows, it's not just one. There's going to be one with a cobra sight, which you're going to probably want to use for more close quarter scenarios, and then there's going to be one with a larger scope. It's debatable on what it's going to be right now. Some say it's with the 6X, some say it's with the 8X. There's actually been 2 different images or videos that actually show it with both, so maybe it will have both, but I'm assuming it's going to be locked with one. There's also no unlocks for this weapon. The ammo types are all earned through assignments, and it's not actually a main weapon, which is a really interesting thing. For Assault, Engineer, and Recon, it replaces your gadget in slot 1. For Support, though, it's a little bit different. It replaces your gadget in slot 2. Now, there's 4 different ammo types for this weapon. You got Standard, Scan, Explosive, and Balance. Standard bolts are mid-range, mid-damage, quick reload. This is the jack-of-all-trades, can do a bit of everything. So this is going to be probably one you're going to want to get used to, and then you can dive into the other ones. Scan, this is more like a proximity sensor. It provides a small blip on the map when the arrow hits. It's not very long-lasting, so people will really have to be watching their map, but it will allow you to scan an area at range because when it hits, it'll reveal a map there. So it's a really interesting mechanic that how that'll work and to see how much damage a scan bolt will actually do. Then you've got the explosive bolt. Now this is going to kind of work like a noob tube. It's going to blow up terrain, walls, and other things like that. It can damage vehicles. I'm assuming it's not going to be a ton of damage to vehicles. And it's a very heavy bolt, so it's going to have a ton of drop in the shot. So it's not going to be very good for distance. This is close quarters and mostly for making your way through a map, destroying walls and such. And then you've got the balance bolt. This is your long range bolt. This one's a very slow reload, but it one hits no matter where you hit anybody. It could be a body shot, so we'll see how the community feels about this one. And then we have the new game mode, Scavenger. This is a really interesting mode because it's a mix of a few other modes, or it has some elements from a few other modes. It has flags like Conquest, but it has no vehicles on any of the maps. And the flags cap quick. If you've played Conquest Domination, it's going to be pretty much like that as far as flag capping goes. In this mode, you also do not have a primary weapon. You start with a pistol and a grenade. You get to select which pistol you want, though, so that's kind of nice. Now, what I think is really nice about this mode is there's a lot of people out there who have their weapon. They have that one or two weapons that they are very comfortable with, and this is going to break them of that. A really common one is the M16A3. You're not going to be able to get your ideal weapon. I mean, you might sometimes. It's going to be random. It's going to be forcing people out of their niche, and maybe they'll find some other weapons that they're really comfortable with, so I think that it's going to be a really nice mode for that. It'll allow people to diversify a little bit more. Beyond that, now how the spawns basically work for weapons is there's three different tiers. You got level one, which is going to be SMGs or PDWs, and what they call lesser weapons. I'm not sure if they're just referring to the SMGs here and calling them lesser weapons, but that's just what they say in the patch notes, is lesser weapons. Now these are found in safe spots. In the outside of the map, these are going to be the easiest weapons to get without actually really committing to it and risking dying. Then you move on to level 2 weapons. These are things like the crossbow, shotgun, and sniper rifles. These are going to be found a bit closer to the interior of the map, and they're going to be a little bit more dangerous to get to. And finally, we have level 3. This consists of assault rifles, carbines, and large machine guns. These are going to be in the most dangerous spots to get to. These are going to be the weapons that you're going to have to risk it the most for, but they also might provide the most reward, so it's really interesting. I'm kind of surprised they went with the tiered system, but we'll see how it works out. And the last thing about this mode is all weapons will only be able to be reloaded once. After that, you're going to have to switch back to your pistol or find another weapon to use. So this is, once again, I think another really nice mechanic, because it's going to basically force you to keep moving to those spawn points, which is going to be conflict areas. There's going to be a lot of fighting there, and it's also going to force you to get used to using many different weapons, because you're only going to be able to use the first clip out of that weapon and the second clip out of that weapon, and then you have to move on to something else. Now, let's talk a little bit about the new maps. There's going to be four of them, and they're going to be between vanilla BF3 map sizes for some of the smaller maps like Scene Crossing and Grand Bazaar, and the size of some of the close quarter maps. The first map that I'm going to cover is called Epicenter. Now, this one's mostly highways and roads, many of which are destroyed because of the earthquake and the aftershocks that follow it. This is a map that is slightly smaller than Grand Bazaar. There's no real other information out there about it, so it's really open to what this one could be. Marquez Monolith, though, we have a bit more information on. This has a huge skyscraper in it where the four bottom levels are playable areas, and the design of this area is more like a civilian mall type theme. Now, the really interesting thing about this map is it has tanks. It has a T-90 and an Abrams. The Little Bird has been confirmed for consoles, and it sounds like for PC, we're going to be getting the availability of all vehicles on this map, but it has not been 100% confirmed, so it's just something to think about. Now, it's really interesting to hear that, though, because that means this is going to be a pretty decent-sized map, because it's going to have the availability of all vehicles, possibly. Then we have Azidi Palace. This is another map that they haven't released a ton of information about. It's basically a large parliament building that has tunnels underneath it. Now, when I think of that, it basically makes me think of Danya Fortress. So I'm assuming it's going to have gameplay a lot like that, and it's probably not going to be a very large map, and it probably won't have any vehicles on it. And then the last map from this download content is called Talam Market. This is going to be a hillside village type of setting. It's going to have many open spaces, but it's also going to have a lot of narrow alleyways. And supposedly this is the largest map, so it's really interesting that they haven't talked about this map more, and they've talked about Marquez Monolith, which also has vehicles, because if this is bigger, I'm assuming it's going to be the same type of scenario. We're going to have vehicles on this map as well, and this should be a lot of fun, having a village type setting with some open spaces and also some hallways to actually fire down. And now let's talk about weapon changes. There are a few weapon changes that are coming from this patch, not nearly as many as what came with Armored Kill. These are mostly balancing changes, and I mean, that's what that patch was as well. These are just bringing weapons in line with what they should be, small tweaks to help them, or, well, to hurt them, to make them fit in against other weapons. The first interesting one that I thought was the M416. Now, they're increasing the first shot recoil and the horizontal recoil on this slightly, and the idea there is to, once again, try and make it more competitive of a choice with the M16A3. Right now, the M416 is kind of the go-to weapon, so some small nerfs for it to bring it in line with some other assault rifles. Then we've got the AUG. Now, this is one I've already covered in a review. they are reducing the first shot recoil on this weapon, which I think is really interesting. The idea is to give more controllability of this weapon, and I already felt it was an extremely controllable gun. The first shot recoil is really the only thing that makes it a little wild, so it should be a really easy to fire weapon now. That should be very easy for a lot of people to just jump in and use this. And then we've got the LSAT. They're increasing the hip accuracy on this, which is a really interesting change, because this is kind of a medium LMG. It's the one that makes the jump to the bigger LMGs, and it has the worst hip firing accuracy. I'm not sure if they're going to make its hip firing accuracy as good as the small LMGs like the QBB or the L86A2, so it'll be really interesting to see where they put this. This is going to be kind of a bridge gap up to the medium LMGs now. And next we have a Type 88 change. They're reducing the recoil on this weapon to make it a more viable option when compared with the M249. I think that's really interesting, because the Type 88 fires 150 rounds per minute slower than the M249, so I'm not sure exactly why they're trying to compare these weapons to each other. I'm assuming it's mostly because they're both medium LMGs, so I'm thinking that in order to make that Type 88 really competitive, they're going to need to reduce the recoil by a lot, because the M249 fires so much faster. So it'll be really interesting to see exactly what they do with this weapon. And then we've got the M5K. This has been a really great weapon after the armored kill patch because of the damage change on it. Also, the fact that it has very little side-to-side recoil and a decent amount of vertical recoil. It makes this weapon, as long as you control that vertical recoil, an easy weapon to put on the spot. And they're going to be changing that around. They're going to be increasing the horizontal recoil and decreasing the vertical recoil. Now, it's easy to control vertical recoil because all you have to do is pull down left and right horizontal recoil. You can't control it as easy because you can't just pull your gun left and right. So it makes this weapon a little bit more wild. It's going to be harder to control. So they're hoping that this brings it in line, because right now this thing just shoots lasers. And then we have a change to the UMP. Now, this is going to be a really interesting one. With the last patch, this weapon got a buff in damage to 34, and I have heard a lot of people complaining about it. I don't necessarily agree with that, but their plans to balance it out seems to be to reduce its rate of fire. They want to differentiate it from the PP2000, because I guess they're a little too similar right now, and the UMP is the obvious choice because it does more damage per shot. And then there's one pistol that's being changed, and that's the MP412 Rex. They're going to be increasing its accuracy to help distinguish it more from the 44 Magnum. That'll be interesting to see. I kind of wish that it had better iron sights, but the accuracy should be really nice. I really enjoy this weapon personally right now, so I think that that's a good change for that weapon. And finally, we're also getting some fixes. There's been a bug for a while now, I believe it's since the armored kill patch, where the M16 and the M5K weren't as affected by suppressive fire as other weapons, and that's going to be fixed, so now they will be fully suppressed as would any other weapon. And then we've got the L86A2 Heavy Barrel's hip accuracy penalty. Right now, I guess it's actually far higher than it should be. It's basically, when you have the heavy barrel on that, it's the equivalent of almost a heavy machine gun, whereas it's a small machine gun. It's meant to have really good hip firing accuracy. If you have the heavy barrel on the L86 as compared to the QBB, it actually has almost twice as much spread as the QBB, and they're both small light machine guns, so that's going to be fixed and probably brought in line with what the values are of the QBB, or very close to there. Then we've got two fixes that are kind of for glitches that are with terrain or with game modes. I don't play a ton of Rush, but I guess that there is a bug right now where the MCOM stations couldn't be disarmed from the left side while standing up. Now, I'm not sure if that was all the time or if that was some of the time, but that's definitely a big problem, and that's going to be fixed. If you played Rush, hopefully that will make you pretty happy. Then there's a few maps out there that had terrain collision problems. Basically, you could hide inside of the terrain or inside of like a wall, and you'd still be able to shoot out at people. So I think there was four or five different maps that had problems like that, and those should all be fixed now. And then we've got the gunship nerf. They think that the gunship's a little too powerful, basically, against infantry. So the gunship forward-looking infrared view has been removed. The position is actually still there, but the infrared view is no longer available. And the damage radius of the cannon explosions has been reduced, once again, because of infantry. People were killing infantry too easy with it, so DICE made a few changes to help infantry out here. And then the last change that we got, or the last fix, is some metal tweaks. DICE felt that, basically, some of the metals were too hard to get. They don't really go into specifics except for with recon. That's the only metal that they actually mention, and they don't even mention the changes for it. I'm assuming it's basically just going to be a reduction in the amount of ribbons that you need to actually achieve the metal. So if you're playing recon, this should help your score per minute climb a bit more, because getting that metal will be easier to get, and that's a 10,000 point bonus each time that you do get it. They don't mention ribbons at all, so I'm interested to see if they're actually going to tweak those as well, but it seems like they won't. And that's basically it as far as interesting information goes that I have seen. You know, we're getting some new maps, we're getting some weapon changes, we're getting some fixes, we're getting one new weapon, we're getting a new game mode. So some really nice things to see. We'll have to see how the new maps play out and how some of these weapon changes work out. So I hope you guys enjoyed the video. I hope that some of this information was new stuff to you guys. And you can always check out my weapon reviews, and I'm sure I'll be doing some reviews of the maps and the gameplay of Scavenger on the new download content when it comes out. So I hope I see you guys in the battlefield. Thanks for watching. This is Kurgan.